Hey everybody, coming to you from my backyard with my fire pit. Throughout my YouTube time, like I say, I always get lots of messages and questions and comments, and there was a few times in the past that the discussion was brought up about baking. Now, I think everybody understands that cooking in general over a campfire is pretty much a non-issue. You have a fire, it hits the bottom of whatever you have hanging over the fire, and it cooks it. Okay, it's a cooking process. I'm not sure. I guess like if you had a liquid, you're boiling because the flame's hitting the bottom. So, baking is different. Baking is, you can look at it two different ways. Baking is heat coming from the top down. Or you can also look at it as an object being completely surrounded by hot air, which is like cakes, breads, cornbread, muffins, you know, anything that requires baking and rising. So, anyway, I casually mentioned to a few friends one time that you don't have to haul around a reflector oven or set you up a metal box for baking, that it's possible to bake while hanging over a campfire. And I tried to explain it in the past, and whenever I have, you can't explain it. It's just something that you got to show. And everybody said I was crazy and said it's just not possible. There's no way that you can hang over a fire and bake something. So I have a rig that was passed on to me that has been set up. And a little bit of background information on it is the guys that took me under their wing and showed me a lot of what they know. Flathead Ed and Big Nose Mac. Okay, I think I've talked a lot more about Flathead Ed than I have Mac, but Mac really did a lot of homemade things, and Mac was a character. Mac drove around. He had a 1961 Chevrolet pickup truck, short bed, dark green, white hubcaps, six-cylinder, three on the tree, white ladder rack. During the week, the ladder rack was covered in ladders. And in the back of it, it was covered in paint cans and caulk. And on the weekends, he usually had a canoe up there on his ladder rack. And but he always kept a burlap sack in the back of his truck. And not a small burlap sack, but one of these gigantic ones that has coffee beans in it. And he always, inside these big burlap sacks, he always had all kinds of goodies in here, all kinds of homemade baking devices. And these baking devices that he had in here, I happen to have a bag full of his stuff. And I'm not going to dig through here and show you a lot of the stuff that was ever in here. It's going to be surprises for future videos. But he could pretty much handle, with his homemade contraptions, he could handle anything, any cooking process that you could ever dream of. Okay? So I'm going to explain to you this little jewel right here and what it is and how it came to be and how it works. And then we're going to make us some cornbread. For those of you out there that are my age, you may remember years ago, and you may remember some of you fans of movies from back in the 50s and 60s, the way ice chest used to be. Like you would see Dean Martin and people drinking martinis and stuff in an apartment. And they had an ice chest, or an ice bucket, I guess. And during the 70s, when I was growing up, I remember they were like plastic and covered in wood grain. But earlier than that, back in the 60s and possibly the 50s, they were made out of aluminum, or as some people pronounce, aluminium, or as I call that shiny silver stuff. But what this is an old, from 50s or 60s, what it is it's an old ice bucket. Okay, and what it was, the way it was designed, of course, it's got a handle. And before, when it had this lid, I have the original parts that went inside it. Now, the way the original lid went is it was a two-piece lid, okay, and there was a handle on the top that screwed through into the bottom. And this inside here was actual fiberglass insulation, and that's what got it insulated, and that's what kept the cold in it. Okay, there was that part. Now, inside, it's a two-piece deal, okay? And there was a rubber seal around here that sealed off the inside from the outside. And as the inside comes out, the inside of the outside had fiberglass around it, around the sides and around the bottom, okay? So now all this was removed, okay? So what you have now is you have this hanging vessel with a lid, okay? Now here's the other part of it. The other part of it in here is, for those of you that remember, let me dig around in here, this little jewel is what's called a crock pot bread and cake bake, okay? Now this little jewel here is anodized aluminum, or once again, aluminium. It's got a gold anodized coating on it. And what this was designed for was designed for the crock pot. And there's something about these vents that allow you to bake in a crock pot. Now, you might could set up, I have this set up, and it's worked before, and you may can emulate a setup somehow or another by having a container in a container with vents. But this little jewel here, they quit making, I think, in the 70s, possibly early 80s. But this is a very popular item. I'm going to show you what it says on the bottom. Sweep this over. See if I can get it in focus. There it is. A rival company, crock pot, bread, and cake bake. Okay, let's ease back off here. Now, and the way this jewel is designed right here is the way it has, it's got these notches up on the side, these things here where the lid is notched, and that's how it goes on and off. Now the idea behind locking it in that way is so that you can hold it by the handle, the knob up on top, and you can put it inside the crock pot and pull it out like this, and it completely covers it up. Okay, now the idea behind the way this little jewel, I've seen these on eBay. They don't make them no more, but you can still find them. If you're lucky, you'll find one at a thrift store or a flea market. This is in relatively good shape, okay? I haven't seen many of them. If you ever see one, buy it. Now, the way this works is as the flames are hitting on the bottom, it'll burn whatever you're trying to bake. So you want a space between them. So what I do is I take a piece of bent tubing, stainless steel tubing, lay it in the bottom, and then set this in, okay? All right, so what you're gonna do now is you're gonna be heating up this entire vessel. You're gonna be heating up this entire vessel. And another thing is the vents, there's something about the way these were designed. I found some of the original literature on this crock pot bake bread maker thing. And the way the vents are supposed to be made to keep whatever's inside it from drying out as it cooks. I don't know how it works, but they're there and they work, okay? And then I also keep this thing on, okay, the gutted lid, the top part of the lid. I put it on there because not only does it kind of sort of trap the ashes, keep the ashes out, but it also helps keep the hot air inside to do the baking, okay? All right, now enough of that. I've rambled on. I've already spent seven minutes yakking. So what we're going to do is we're going to get a fire going, and I'm going to preheat that pot right there. Okay. There's two little tricks to baking over a fire. One of them is whatever vessel you're going to use for your baking, you need to preheat it. Okay. And then another trick is the way the fire is done, and it works better in a fire pit. And I'll show you how I arrange the wood.
This is the permanent fire pit that I have set up in my backyard that I use. Okay.
So what you want to do is you want to take pieces of wood and you want to line the outsides. Okay, and what I usually do is I'll put in four large pieces of wood. Or, as some people say, fuel, because the larger wood is considered the fuel, and the smaller is considered the kindling, because the kindling is what gets the fire going. Okay, and I kind of alternate large pieces and small pieces. But the idea of this is you don't necessarily want all the fuel directly under. You want the fuel around the outside, okay? And as you're preheating, let's see, move this around, I'm trying to make it all fit. As you're preheating, what you're gonna do is to get the fire going. Okay, I looked up, that is just the right amount of wood. Okay, I have this set up. I have the wood all around the outside.
move this out of the way. But what you want to do now is you're going to pile a bunch in the middle. Okay. And what you're going to do there is that's where you're going to get the fire going. And then as all the sticks turn into burning embers, they're going to fall down to the bottom of the pit, and they're going to catch all the other stuff on fire. This will be the preheat stage. Okay. So I'm going to light this part and get it going. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put some fat wood right in the middle, and then I'm going to start piling sticks on top of that. Let's see, to get things going here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use just a piece of fat wood, and let's see if I can baton it into some pieces, because I don't want to really feel like it's been raining a lot here lately, and this stuff's kind of wet. I don't really want to mess around with this too long. Let's see what we did here. This stuff's very, very knotty. Not naughty, knotty. All right. That looks pretty good. I don't know. Maybe I'll just start with two pieces. Yeah, I'm going to save that piece. All right, I'm going to lay these two pieces in there, and I'm going to fire them up. Over towards the fire. There you go. All right. Good old lighter in a pouch. This isn't a survival video. This is a backyard cooking video, so I'm allowed to use a lighter. All right. And what I'm going to do, kind of mash that down. What I'm going to do is I'm going to light this and then just set it over here on the top and then start piling more kindling on it. This fat wood is just some amazing stuff. You don't even have to feather it to get it going. Once you get the tip going, you turn it up a little bit. Well, maybe not, the wind's blowing. Let's try it again. The wind's blowing pretty hard. Can't even light. That's pretty bad right there. It's gonna make me look like an idiot. Let me hang it over here a minute. Alright. Now that I look like an idiot, I'm not gonna edit that out, because this is the way things are. I'm going to show you how to get this stuff going like this. The wind keeps blowing it out. All right, can you see what you do is? See how I've curled the edge up? That's another way of getting it going. All right, let's try this again. There we go. Woo. Now you got a big flame there, you can just hold the other one over it. And it'll get it going. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to pile that stuff on top of it. And that'll get it going good. If it's a real wet condition outside, this will work. This is a good method. Now see that right there? That turned black and it didn't even catch on. This is a pretty good lesson with fat wood. Sometimes it works good and sometimes it don't. Other times, you have to curl it up like this. Now see, this will catch right on. See, even fat wood needs to be feathered. All right, now I'm gonna start piling the sticks on. I'm just piling tons of sticks on it now and getting it going good. And then everything, all those embers will just fall down to the bottom and catch everything else on fire. And like I say, this is also the preheat stage for your baking vessel, whatever it is you decide to use. If you ever have you a chance to set up a fire pit in your backyard, set it up, because I've got a fire pit and a grill set up in my backyard, and I make coffee constantly, and I cook food in the yard all the time. I pick up all the sticks and branches out of the yard and put them in a big pile and cook over it. Let's see, wait a minute. You want to take some Crisco or some spray and spray the inside of your pan. You don't want to spray your pan after it's already hot. You want to spray it real good ahead of time. The best way of doing it is with Crisco, but I'm a little lazy today. Put the lid on, turn it, hold it up. Put this in the bottom. That's on top of that piece of stainless steel, so there's a gap there. You can see the flames are coming up on the fire, so that's good. Hang it from my hanging stick. Got all my notches on it so it can be adjusted. All right, that ought to preheat it real good. I'm gonna let that sit there preheat for a little while. And once everything turns into embers and falls down in there, then I'll mix up the cornbread mix and we'll dump it in. And it takes about an hour to an hour and a half, depending on the fire. All right, as you can see, that fire is really roaring now. And that's wonderful. That's what you want. And you're not going to hurt that pan one bit. Because like I say, this fire's going to die down here in about 5 minutes. And you're preheating that thing really good. So I'm thinking it's going to be preheated enough that we're going to start mixing up our cornbread mix now. Now I could see all of the sticks and things falling towards the center, which is good. Okay. Now what I'm using is cotton country cornbread mix. Okay. This seems to work pretty good over these campfire recipes. You just add 3/4 cup of water. And incidentally, while I'm at it, I'm not sure about the temperature of a campfire due to wood and how it's set up and how the air is fed in and how ambient temperature affects it. But without getting too much into details of all that, I will say this. Any of these mixes, if you buy a muffin mix, cornbread mix, cake mix, bread mix, doesn't matter what it is, any of these like this that you're going to be bringing to camp with you, if you put water in them, if they mix with water, they're the type that bake in around the 400 degree range. Okay, if it's the kind of mix that you put in milk and eggs and not water, they are going to bake at around the 300 something range. Okay, just a little food for thought, depending on what time of year it is, how cold it is outside, you know, things like that. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to use my container that it was in originally that I showed you earlier. It's easy down here. Now what I used to do is I used to put this in a Gatorade bottle and shake it up, but it wound up being lumpy. So what I have discovered works best is I put the water in first. Okay, 3/4 cup of water. I usually carry it in a Gatorade bottle. All right. then I start stirring the water as I'm slowly adding it in. See, it's already coming out in lumps. I should have got something done about them lumps to begin with. You got to stir it for a good long time to get the lumps out of it. Shaking it, sometimes on the camp trail, I would shake it in a bottle and that kind of screwed it up. I don't know why. Somebody that knows more about baking may know than I do. And so that's what you want. Keep adding a little bit at a time and get it smooth and get them lumps out of there. And see, this is perfect timing right here because I can see that my fire is dying down. So I got some lumps in here now. This is exciting, ain't it? I wish I had another exciting story to tell you, but I don't. All right, now my fire's about dying down. Like I say, one of the keys to making this work is preheating your pan to begin with, okay? So let's pull the pan off, and I'm gonna pour it in. I think I'll bring the pan over here. Let's see, you may find, there you go, leather. Set this down. I got you in camera range. All right, let's pull this off. All right, see that smoke coming off? That's a good thing. Let's pull this out. I say what's bad is if you're ever on a surface that's not level, when you pour the batter in, it won't be level. It'll get crooked. I see. I got that a little bit too hot. It burned up the stuff inside it. Let me pour that out and respray that. I don't like that. That's gonna mess up my stuff. Well, I think there's still some spray in there. I think I just put too much in there. All right, let's pour this in. Right in the middle. And so you can hear it sizzling. Not to be confused with the air conditioning cutting off on the back of my house. All right, there we go. Now what you want to do is put your lid back on. Yeah, Crisco works so much better. All right, pull this off. Make sure that's reasonably level. Make sure my stainless steel piece is on there. All right, let's drop this down in there. Like I say, not many of you will ever find one of these old ice buckets like this. But the idea is if you can find some way of having a container inside a container and have the inner container vented, then you'll be good to go. Now, when you pick this thing up, you want to try your best to keep everything level, because if you hang it crooked, if you hang this jewel crooked, what's going to happen is you're going to wind up with a very crooked cornbread or cake or whatever. All right, let's see what we're doing here. Come over here and hang down. Now, what I want to do is I'm going to drop it down a little bit lower into the fire. So, I think that'll work right there. All right, I don't want to starve it. I don't want to starve the fire. I don't want to necessarily starve the fire yet. I want to make sure that the bottoms of it's getting good and going. And then when I do, I'm going to lower it all the way down in. Once these logs on the side here have caught on fire real good. Now, it's preheated, and from the time it's preheated and poured in, it'll be exactly 1 hour, okay? So, I'll cut this back on here in maybe 30 minutes and talk to you for a minute, and we'll see how it's doing, and then in an hour I'm gonna pull it off. I eased you down to a level here to where you can see. The problem with this thing is it's going down at an angle and it's gonna make your cornbread uneven, so you want to try to cure that as quick as possible. Now it may have already started baking crooked, but that's what you want to do. You want to make sure and try to get that thing hanging level. That way the cornbread won't be thin on this side and thick on this side. Further explanation of this and why it works the way it does is I'm fixing to show you that you have more flames on the sides than you do the bottom. Okay, it's kind of hard. You really got to get unlucky to burn the bottom of this. So what you're doing is as you're adding fuel to this, you can see down at the very bottom of the pit, there's basically ashes. So if you're gonna add anything, if you add smaller pieces to the outsides, okay, just like that. And what it is there's no more fuel falling down into the bottom of the fire. It's all to the sides, and that's what you want, because you're wanting this thing to be engulfed in a giant ball of heat, but with as little heat as possible in the bottom, okay? Ease this back over a little. All right, we're gonna lower it back down in there. Like I say, you don't have to worry about it burning because that stainless steel tubing is underneath it. What you're doing is you're not getting direct contact with the inner vessel. The outer vessel's taking the heat and there's hot air between the two. So, you know, get on down in there to where it's good and hot, but you don't necessarily have to worry about burning because there's no direct contact. And it takes a lot to hit 400 degrees with a campfire like this. So I'm gonna ease it on down there even more. Right there. See, that way I'm gonna have good heat all around the sides of it. All right, I'll cut you back on in 30 minutes. In about another 15 minutes probably, and you can kind of get the idea there of, let me pull it off. You can see how the underneath there's just nothing but just white ash, and how the logs are burning around on the side there. But that's what you want. You want the heat around the sides and not the bottom. That's part of the magic. Another little tidbit of information is if you're wanting to wonder if this is working right, you want to put your hand up on the top of it right here. And if you can feel just as much heat up here on the top of it as you do down on the sides, then that's a good thing. Because if you don't feel any heat up here, then your fire's nowhere near hot enough. All right, it's been another 30 minutes, so I'm gonna take it off the fire now and I'm gonna let it cool for about 10 minutes and then I'll take the lid off and we'll be good to go. Well, let's ease it down here. I can see what I'm doing. Yeah, I can kind of see. I'll put it right here to cool it. There's old handy lid coming off. All right. Now. All right, I'm gonna set that jewel right there. I'm gonna let it cool for 10 minutes, and then I'm gonna pull the lid off of it, and then we're gonna chow down on us some cornbread. All right, cornbread's still over there cooling. I'm fixing to open it up. It's been like 10 minutes, but I want to ease over here and show you something. After you've taken off the cornbread, you've got this fire that's got all this wood around the edges. What you can do now is you can throw more kindling in the middle, and then just kick all these logs over, and then you've got a good roaring fire going so that you can make coffee or cook beans or whatever. And that's kind of the beauty of this, is because the cornbread that you've made, can sit around camp for a few hours while the beans are being made, and it's a great trail food, the cornbread and beans.
All right, y'all about ready to try this? This will be make or break. Do I look good or do I look like an idiot? You know how I feel about idiots. All right, let's ease on down here now. And pan out right here. Let's see. Take this off. All right. Hey, look, I can pick it up now. Okay. Now that's always a good sign whenever it's busted up in the top. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna kind of cut around the outside. All right, let's flip it over. Oh, there we go. All right, now the bottom did get a little bit burnt right around here, but what I'm thinking that is that's where the stuff was, the spray. Now here in the middle, it didn't get burnt too bad. Now I'm gonna show you this. Got the lid for this thing. So you could just set this inside here, and it could sit around camp for 4 or 5 hours while you're cooking beans. Okay. All right. Now this is what I was talking about it being crooked. Now I didn't catch it quick enough. Okay. So now what I'm going to do is instead of this thin side, I'm going to cut into this thick side over here. Moment of truth. Is it going to be done or am I going to be an idiot? All right. Usually if the thickest part of it is done, then you know that you're successful. Cornbread is just a fantastic thing on the trail. And you can also make, yes, completely done. Okay? This is the reason why it's called the magic of baking. Okay? Because it was hanging over a fire. You can see it's done through and through. And you can see the bottom is just a touch dark, but it's not burnt. I mean, that's edible, okay? You can do cakes this way. You can do muffins this way. You can also win bets. Mac used to actually win bets a lot of times with people that were camping nearby that... people that were experienced in cooking, they said that you had to have some kind of a reflector oven of some kind back then. I think Coleman had some kind of a fold-out oven. And people used cardboard boxes with aluminum and foil in them and stuff. And he used to say, well, I can hang over the fire and bake a cake. And everybody was like, no way. And people actually started putting money up. And old Mac made a lot of money that way. Anyway, you probably won't be able to find an old ice chest container thing like this, but if you can emulate this by whatever you can find where you can put a vessel inside a vessel, and somehow or another that vented lid, if you can find one of these, you're really going to be well off, because this is part of the magic too. Okay. Two of the key things, like I say, remember, if you have the fire around the outside, if you can, you'll have some fire under it, but try to concentrate it on the outside. And very important, preheat your pot, pan, or vessel, or whatever you plan on using. Now, when I went to churches, every time I go to church's chicken, I always steal some of their honey sauce. Butter's good on cornbread too, but if you add this honey sauce, I mean, it's like dessert. So, here's a test to see if it tastes any good. Mmm. Honey sauce. Oh man, that is so good. The bottom is edible. The bottom is not bad, and like I say, part of that is due to the fact that if you lay something in the bottom, your inner pan is not contacting your outer pan, therefore you're not going to burn. It's just there's hot air underneath it. This is so good. If you can rig up something like this,
I mean, I know I'm in my backyard, but I didn't have time to run out in the woods and spend a couple of hours cooking. So, and I've got a fire pit, so I went ahead and did it here. And out of all the cornbread mixes, that one, that Cotton Country, it's delicious. So, all right. I hope y'all give this a try. Try to rig you something up. Rig you up a hanging pot with something like this, and maybe you can find you one of these outfits at a thrift store. Or there's a few on eBay. So, all right. I'm going to eat some more, and I got to go. I will see you in the next one.